question. Will, thank you very much for joining us here in Atlanta for Siege, and take it away.
Okay, well, thanks, Andrew. Nice introduction. And as many of you might not know, Atlanta is my hometown. That's where I was born. So I am an honorary Georgian. So Andrew asked me to come talk today. And, you know, I get very bored about talking about my old projects. I always like talking about my new projects. So I'm going to spend most of my time here today kind of giving you a brief run through of, you know, kind of where I've gone creatively and in my headspace. You know, I've always been very interested in gamers. You know, a long time ago, I kind of started realizing that, you know, I was really programming two computers or two things. You know, there's a computer, PlayStation, whatever in front of you, but then there's the mind of the gamer. And that actually is the much more interesting processor that I think a game designer has to deal with. You know, the one of them is just code, very, you know, straightforward, very logical. But the purpose of that really is to affect the mind of the gamer, which is a much more complicated piece of machinery. And I found over my career that I've just become much more obsessed with what goes in the mind of a player as they're playing games. When I started doing like SimCity, you know, my first game was Red Armuggling Bay, and you basically flew around blowing up things, you know, which was okay. That was fine. I love blowing up things. But I started realizing that I was having more fun building these worlds than I was blowing them up. And that kind of led me to SimCity. And when I did SimCity, I started seeing the constructs that players were making in the game. And it was very interesting how I got an insight into the way the players were thinking, just looking at the cities that they constructed. You know, they were concerned about crime or traffic or whatever. But it was kind of an insight into what was going on in the mind of the player. You know, in their mind, what was the ideal city? So over my career, I think I've migrated more and more towards the internal mind of the player and using the computer as more of a compiler to build these elaborate internal models of the player. Now, the project I'm working on right now is very much based upon memory. You know, really, over my career, I think I have, again, migrated closer and closer to the player to where now I kind of want to make the internal mind of the player the landscape of the game. And I got very fascinated with the idea of memories. You know, what are memories? And, you know, what makes me think the way I think? You know, what is it that, you know, who I am is a product of really all my experiences in the world. One of my favorite, I was always a big Trekkie. I actually, embarrassingly, went to a lot of Trekkie conventions way, way back, you know, like in the late 70s and stuff. Actually got to meet Scotty. I built a model of the Enterprise deck bridge. And he presented it to Scotty, and it was just amazing. One of my favorite episodes actually was Star Trek The Next Generation. It was called The Inner Light. And the Enterprise comes across this probe. They don't know what it is. It's just sitting out in the middle of nowhere. It zaps the captain. You know, he falls unconscious. And all of a sudden, we go to the captain's point of view, when he wakes up on this world. And it's, you know, a totally different world, and everybody's telling him he had a fever, he was delirious, and he's trying to convince everybody he was captain of a starship, and no, 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 you've lived here your whole life, and he ends up living on this planet for years and years and raising kids, and he finally kind of accepts the fact that, okay, that whole thing about being a starship captain was delusional. He makes friends, he has grandchildren, he learns to play the flute over many years very badly. You know, which I kind of appreciate the idea that, you know, he kind of learned to appreciate playing the flute, even though he played it badly. But then he wakes up on the bridge of the Enterprise 20 minutes later. You know, he says, how long has it been? 20 minutes. But from his point of view, it's been 20 years. And the only thing on that probe was a little flute that he had learned to play. And he picks it up and starts playing it fluently. But the gist of this whole episode was that you can embed a set of memories in somebody and it changes who they are. So over 20 minutes, he had a whole lifetime of memories embedded in his head, and he became a different person. And I really thought that was kind of interesting. And I've seen that in other science fiction as well. There's a movie called Dark City, where these kind of alien creatures were embedding different memories in people every day just to kind of study the way they would react and behave, you know. But again, it was kind of, you know, rebooting their personality. One of my favorite old movies was this movie called Forbidden Planet. And in this movie, these people from Earth come to a planet that has been inhabited by this ancient civilization, and they have these elaborate, giant underground constructs of machinery and whatever. And there's only one scientist that was remaining from an earlier expedition, Dr. Morpheus, and he starts showing them how the Krell, who is this ancient civilization, had developed these tools for enhancing their mind. And he would attach himself to this machine, and he could project images from his imagination, and it was basically an amplifier on his mind, on every part of his mind, which he didn't quite realize. And the interesting part of this was that actually the deep part of his subconscious was being amplified, you know, into this monster on the surface. He really didn't want these people here messing with him, but he wouldn't admit that. But his id became manifest through this. You know, this dark, deep subconscious part of his mind became manifest through this machinery under the surface. And it was actually, you know, one of the cool quotes from that movie was, you know, beware monsters of the id. You know, one of the guys kind of realized finally what was happening was that this guy's id was being projected onto the planet. I get kind of fascinated with this idea that there is a deep part of each of us in our mind that we don't really have direct access to. That, you know, Freudians, we call it the id or subconscious, whatever. But I became interested in, you know, is there a way that we could somehow build a, like a gaming experience, entertainment experience, where we could start bringing that to life, mapping it, putting a, you know, a microscope on it. And so that kind of led me to the current project that I'm working on, which we're calling Proxi. Now, Proxi is basically an attempt to get into the mind of the player and to map it out, to make it manifest, to bring it to life, you know, eventually, and play with it, you know, make it a playful, interesting experience, but basically it's a microscope on your mind. You know, can we basically find a gaming experience where you're doing stuff, you're interacting, and it's, you know, the basic aspect of this is memory, really. We look at the different ways in which players interact with games, the different type of players that we see come to games. And a lot of people come to games with very different motivations. And so we have to kind of take that into account. You know, how do we build an experience that will kind of satisfy all these different player types? But at the same time, do something kind of interesting and meaningful. I've always been interested in building entertainment experiences around reality, around the real world. The real world is amazing, you know. And a lot of games kind of purposely go off towards, I think, fantasy, which is fine. I enjoy these games a lot. But the type of things I like to work on are things that kind of make you walk away from the game and see the world a little bit differently. You know, it actually kind of gives you a different filter to see the world through. In Proxi, you know, we actually have kind of all these different zoom levels, you know, depending on what exactly you're interacting with. But this is one of the metaphors, you know, that basically we go from very granular to, you know, to very high level. And we make the users, you know, kind of feel comfortable in terms of understanding the spatiality and scalability of this. Now, I'm going to talk about four different levels of Proxi. And these basically are kind of zoom levels. At the most basic zoom level, you know, what we're trying to do is harvest memories from your life. And these aren't so much memories that you would post maybe on Facebook. It's not like, you know, what happened yesterday at Starbucks. These are more like, you know, what are the, you know, three or four dozen most important memories of your life? You know, everybody can kind of think back and, oh, yeah, that was happened to me when I was 25 years old, and it really changed the way I thought about this or whatever. But I think anybody can kind of go back and say, you know, these were two or three dozen memories that really carried with me through my life, and it changed who I am. Now, from there, we actually take these memories after players create them with our UGC tools, and we place them into a little world. And the player actually constructs this world. They construct the terrain. They place the memories wherever they want. There's actually a whole resource management aspect to this. Little roads are created between related memories. So you can see that these two memories share some concept. It might be pets. It might be an activity. It might be a person. But the user is in control of this world. The user is, you know, basically constructing this almost like SimCity. From that, we actually kind of zoom out now. And based upon what they've, the concepts that they've placed in their memories, we actually start building a much larger map, a topology of the way the player thinks. And we kind of call that, you know, basically this is Proxy's brain. And when we refer to Proxi, this Proxi is kind of an avatar that we eventually create of your subconscious. Based upon all the events in your life, the way you think about things, you know, I'm really kind of interested, can we map the way different people think and how is it unique to them? You know, because once we've started mapping out the associations in your memories, we can now compare that to all the other players, you know, and it might be that you have a lot of things that are very in common with everybody else, but other things that maybe are very unique to you. You know, maybe most other people think of spiders as scary, but for some reason you think of spiders as tasty or fun. And Proxy will kind of drill in on that and find out, hey, wait, that's kind of, you're really an outlier in this area. And Proxy is going to try to accentuate the areas in which the way you think and the associations that you have are unique compared to the crowd. So I'm going to go through each one of these one at a time just to give you kind of a sense of how we think about it in design and where we're going with this, starting with memories. Now, in memories, we basically start with just six categories of things: people, activities, feelings, places, things, and time. Now, the basic aspect of a memory in this game is that you just enter keywords for each of these for memory. And the keywords are totally open. You can put whatever you want. You know, for people, I can put Uncle Bob or Mom or whatever. Same with any one of these fields. You can be as specific or as general as you like. Underneath the hood, Proxy is going to be doing kind of a conceptual matching with an AI layer. So I might put in cat or dog, but Proxy will understand that those are both probably pets. And it will understand that two memories are related because they both involve pets, even though you put cat in one memory and dog in another. But Proxy also starts recognizing associations that you might have through your memories. I associate my mother with this feeling or that place, or Uncle Bob with that activity. And that's what Proxy is really trying to map out for each individual player. Now, as a player creates these memories, we want them to be able to put in, you know, imagery and a lot of other things that help kind of, you know, respawn that memory in your head. These are almost like handles, you know. So we kind of came up with the metaphor of something like a snow globe. So for every memory, in addition to these categorized keywords, these are just creating a little scene, you know, and it could be photographic, it could be 3D models, particle effects, ambient sounds. But each one of these little bubbles is kind of like your snow globe of that memory that you're crafting for yourself. And, you know, we're building a lot of tools to make these things easy to craft and eventually easy to share if you choose to do so. You know, there's a whole very deep privacy aspect to this that in the design, we always hit this thing of, you know, do we want people to ever try to game the memories, or do we want them to put in authentic, real memories? And at every step, we've tried to keep it so that the player is incentivized to put in real memories from their real life, so that we get accurate results when we're mapping their mind. So that whenever you choose to share one of these, we want to make it extremely obvious and overt that the users decide to do that. Otherwise, all these are very private, because, I mean, a lot of things you want to put into here are things you may not want to share. So we went through a lot of design exercises in terms of, you know, what's the simplest way to do this, how do we attach these. I'm not going to go into a lot of details there. But we spent a lot of time on this. This is almost akin to the maybe the creature creator in Spore. These are like the Legos of our world. And so we need making the creation of those Legos to be very fun and interesting. But eventually, you know, the user can craft these memories, make these little snow globes for each one. And they can also, if they want, you know, add either a text or a voice annotation of it. So, in fact, I could sit there and just tell Proxy a story, and Proxy will actually try to catch the keywords and place them in the right categories automatically. But later, you know, at the same time, I'm kind of building a almost a time capsule of my memories. You know, it's like an heirloom, if you will. I really wish that I had this for my grandmother. If my grandmother put in, you know, the 100 most important memories from her life, I would just love perusing that, just getting a sense of the way she saw the world and the way she experienced life. So I think there's a very deep value to this, you know, kind of beyond just the gameplay. And then, you know, of course, in the design process, we're spending a lot of time kind of figuring out, okay, what ways in which player or players going to want to input this. So, you know, we'll start with a photo. I can bring a photo in to begin with, and it will automatically try to tag the photo based upon photo tagging, or I could overtly tell it what the tags are. So there are a lot of different paths the player can take in terms of creating these like little snow globe things. But at the end of the day, you've created a memory, and the next step is that they get placed into this world, and this is your private world of memories. Now, these memories kind of fall into the world, and then, you know, we started thinking about what are the different ways in which I want to visualize this world of my memories, you know, and there are a lot of different kind of approaches to this, and so we spent a lot of time kind of exploring, you know, is this like Disneyland? Is it like a tourist map? Is it, you know, a miniature golf course? You know, there are all these kind of different ways in which you can kind of imagine, visualize it. You know, what's the metaphor, really, for the world in which these live? There's going to be a lot of other aspects in there. You know, as you put a lot of memories that have a similar theme or topic, you will start earning things like monuments. So you might put a lot of memories together that involve sports, and then you earn the sports monument, which will be an interface into much more detailed maps about that. You know, so at some point, as you're populating this world, you start earning more maps of your mind, and it might be a map of your social network. It might be a map of your phobias. It might be a map of childhood traumas, whatever. But we're basically encouraging you as you populate this world and fill it out, that Proxi starts reflecting back more and more what it's learning about you. And again, you know, really the point of this is, can we take the player's mind and make that the gaming landscape? There's this kind of truism that I've always worked from, is that no game designer has ever gone wrong by overestimating the narcissism of their players. You know, in other words, the more the game is about you, the more you're going to be into it, you know. And, you know, I've seen it especially with things like in-game storytelling. You know, I never hear players talking about the cool cutscene they saw in Counter-Strike or Mario. Instead, they sit there and talk about the weird things they did in the game. You know, the user stories that are very unique to them. And that is always so much more motivating to players, I think. You know, the more it's about them, the more they're into it. Aesthetically, you know, we started kind of going down all these paths, and we kind of settled on something that was more like an architectural model, you know, fairly abstract on the terrain side, but the user is constructing all of this terrain. We have terrain tools and, you know, things to decorate, you know, the landscape, biome, generators, weather, stuff like that, almost like the Disney movie Inside Out, you know, to where in your mind you're creating a little world where your life experience is now manifest and tangible, you know, in this world. You can kind of walk around and explore. It's self-discovery. So, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here, but again, you know, we have a lot of UGC opportunities here where players can create unique items and then share them through a marketplace with other players. And so we're hoping that the diversity of these worlds, both aesthetically and kind of functionally, explodes over time. And so everybody's world is extremely unique to them and how they think. Now, as you place these memories in here, it's also looking for connections between them. And we're actually building little road networks. And a lot of the game economy is based around you putting connected memories near each other, roads appearing. You see little agents crawling down the roads that basically are sharing concepts between memories. And the concept might be my mother. It might be snow skiing. It might be pets. It could be anything. But any related memories will now construct kind of an economic road network that's earning you more money. And so there's a whole resource allocation. You know, again, it's almost like SimCity here, except the success of your little world is more based upon how you choose to organize your memories. And we spend a lot of time looking at how the players choose to place these memories within the world to understand even a deeper level of, you know, you tend to think of these two memories as similar, but these two not at all. And so each player within the world, you know, you might have organizations. I might have my island of traumas, or my island of vacations, or my island of best friends from college. You know, every player is going to organize their memories differently, and we learn a lot from the way the players choose to organize their memories here. And of course, there'll be, you know, various levels of editing, landscaping, that kind of thing. So I think the players are going to feel very personally connected to these worlds and how they come out. And as we zoom away from this world, you know, it actually, it's a little planet that you're basically constructing. Building landscapes, decorating it, placing memories in there, earning monuments, managing the traffic on the roads. But this is the way the user chooses to organize their memories. Now, from there, we actually zoom out to the next level. The world is now kind of at the center of this, and we take the concepts that were in all the memories, and we start building a whole topology of the way you think, you know, branching out from those first major categories, people, feeling, places, things, time, etc. And we start building kind of a map of your brain, if you will. So the world that you created of your memories is now the center of this, but as we zoom out, you know, that really is the nucleus that we now start building a topology of all these concepts and how they relate to each other in your mind. So you might organize, you know, the people category in one way. You might put family, friends, old buddies, whatever. Somebody else might organize it totally differently. And again, we're learning a lot about the way you think by how you choose to organize this. And, you know, we want to visualize this as well. And, you know, this is different than the visualization of your brain. This is more a direct visualization of the way you think and the associations you have in your mind. There's this artist, Daniel Zeller, and I got very intrigued with his art. He's very inspired by things like cartography, spatial, you know, kind of representation visually. Makes these really amazing pictures, these drawings. But I was very kind of struck by how unique these each seemed. And I wanted to have everybody's, what we call psychograph, the map of their brain, to be very unique and different. And so we kind of went through this whole process of how can we take the topology that we learn from you, the concepts within your memories and how they relate to each other, how can we turn that into this beautiful, abstract, almost like painting that now represents you? And we did a lot of experiments there. And in fact, you know, it actually is turning out really cool there, so that every person has almost like this mind print that, you know, right off the bat, you can tell it's totally different. And you can even kind of get a sense of how they think based upon, you know, the colors and the shading and all that. We're calling this kind of the psychograph. But basically, this is a visualization that we make of your brain based upon all the stuff that you've entered so far. So it's very different. This is Proxy's organization of your concepts and thoughts and memories as opposed to the way you place them within the world. So your world is kind of the way you chose to organize it. This is Proxy's deeper analysis of the way you think. And there are different things like heat maps where we can show you different maps of the associations, the way you connect things in your head, why, you know, and as I was doing early prototypes of Proxi, I was seeing a lot of strange associations that made total sense to me when I saw them. I associated my father with Sundays, and I can go into the reasons, but it was just very interesting to have this reflection of my mind that was always in there. And as I saw this reflection, it made total sense, but it was kind of amazing that I never really thought of it consciously before. So the world that you created is now at the center of this brain that we are now slowly building, you know, this almost synthetic version of your unconscious or your id. And from there, we kind of pop out to the highest level. And this is what we're calling the proxy. So when we refer to proxy, what we're actually talking about is basically an avatar that we're building of your subconscious. This information. And the more stuff you put in there, the more memories, the more detailed editing that you put into the world, this proxy, and it's going to influence the way this proxy behaves and acts. This proxy can interact with you. And it's interesting because, you know, everybody sees the world a little bit differently. And I think as we get into the social gameplay of this, you know, what's going to be interesting is comparing, you know, our proxies to each other. And depending on, you know, it might be close friends of mine. And so we could actually have, you know, shared memories, but look at the difference in which we interpreted those memories. You know, I might think of, oh, that thing we did last summer was really fun. You might think, oh, it was really stupid or tragic. But as we now start comparing our different perceptions of the world with each other, I think that's where the social gameplay of Proxi is going to be going. And this is the part that we're kind of really digging into right now. But the Proxi-to-Proxi side, you know, it can be me and my close friends. You know, we can basically have a shared world where now I have my private world of memories that I curate, but at the same time, I take my best friends and we have a shared world and we put all the shared memories that we have in there. And it is actually doing a comparison between the way we think about these shared events and highlighting that and building mini games, in fact, around that between us. At the same time, I think we want to start building what I'm calling synthetic proxies, which could be either like historical characters that my proxy is now able to interact with. I can see, you know, how much do I and Albert Einstein have in common, or Karl Marx, or whoever. And we can actually see little conversations between my id, my proxy, and Albert Einstein, which, and Albert Einstein in this case, would be a group construct. You know, any player can come in and contribute, you know, to Albert Einstein, almost like Wikipedia. And so these are basically social group constructs that people are collaboratively building together. And then they have to be historic. It could be, you know, fictional characters as well. And we can build things like leaderboards around these other characters. So that's, you know, the social side of Proxi that we're just kind of really digging into right now. But the Proxi that is interacting in all these activities is basically extracted from the three levels before that of me building my Proxi, the memories, the world, etc., and then the topology. And of course, the game designers, you know, we kind of go through and look at, okay, what are all the different things that are happening here? How are we doing it? Why are we doing it? What's motivating the player? We're putting a big emphasis on UGC here, I think. We want players to create really cool stuff to put in their memories. You know, and again, it could be, you know, 3D models, it could be photographs, it could be ambient sound effects, it could be music. But the richness of that world, the richness of your memories, the richness of your life experience wants to be something that we're not only kind of extracting from the players, but we're encouraging players to share, you know, across each other. So that the next player who's building a memory involving elephants or ping pong or whatever now has a huge amount of content that other players have created to build that little snow globe or to build their world, to decorate their world, or to even put into their proxy as they bring their proxies out to interact with each other. So that is my prepared presentation. I'm going to let Andrew open it up to questions right now, and I'm sure that I blew through this too fast and left a lot of things unsaid, but I think we can probably cover that in the Q&A. A
lot of great information there. Thank you very much, Will. We also had a great session with
Andrew
on Monday with a lot of students who had a lot of questions to ask. So we expect all of you in the pros to do more than just clap, clap, clap. But thank you, Zecmo, and grateful for Disney and Brian Reed. We appreciate all
that. Might be
clicking
questions.
One of the themes that popped up with the students was on security. What were some of the concerns with people?
So as Andrew's collecting questions, my partner Lauren Elliott is going to be showing some links, some useful links that might be going to, you know, some of our user tools or whatever, but we're basically trying to provide user tools as early as possible for players to start building out these worlds. And I didn't really get into the fact that as players are creating unique content for this game, there's going to be an entire economy that's rewarding the creators for creating content that other players consume. So we want that to be almost a Darwinian process, a Darwinian marketplace, so that people that are creating unique content within Proxi, if they choose, it could be shared out to other players. As the other players use that content, they will actually get in-game earnings from that. And so this is really part of us building a UGC community around this idea.
Will, I think I need you to stop sharing
Will, let me
screen so
see if we're supposed to join the voice general chat, because this one we're in now. Let me see if that's true. And I'll share
Let me stop sharing, first of all. Mm-hmm.
And Lauren, if you could introduce yourself while Will is taking care of that.
Okay, so I stopped sharing now.
Okay.
Yep, so Lauren, you should now be able to share. Perfect. And we are meta. Why are we seeing...
I see Andrew is muted.
Sorry, I'm on the stream. Right, Lauren. There we go.
How does that look?
I am seeing the Discord.
Okay, hold on.
If you want to pick another window to stream. While we're going on, Ron Jones, the artist, asks, would interaction with your own proxy be like a scene from Pixar's Inside?
I think Inside Out, you mean. I think the world that they're going through in Inside Out would be very similar to the world that you might choose to build about that. I think, you know, in Inside Out, they're interacting with actually a lot of different proxies, each one representing different emotions. I think it would be a little bit closer that if we, you know, collapsed all those avatars together, the fear, joy, whatever, a little bit closer, but it's in the same general vein, yeah. It's very close to the metaphor.
Lauren, try sharing that one more time on a lower resolution.
Okay.
There we go. Perfect. Okay. So Lauren is showing you the tool sign up. Lauren, can you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit more about what you're showing here?
I'm Lauren Elliott, CEO and partner with Will of Galleon Studios. So Will talked a little bit about the tools that we're busy creating for creating content for the latest game and for other games. So the links I have here, we're just beginning to open up. We just announced it for Siege. The user-generated tools, a tool set that lets users create content for the game. So there's a link here for that, the tool sign-up page. It's a beta program, and we're just rolling it out. So if you'll sign up, we'll get back to everybody as soon as we can. But it'd be wonderful to have artists and anyone interested in it to sign up for. So that's it. The tool sign-up is there, and the sign-up for that proxy site is also there. So please take a look, and if it's some of interest to you, please sign up for it. And we'll have another presentation, our CTO and art director, this Sunday. I believe it's at 1 o'clock. Timothy Johnson and Rebecca Harrison are showing off the tools, a kind of walkthrough of the tools. So if you're interested in that, it would be a great introduction to it. So that's what that is.
Some of you in chat know Timothy Johnson from working here in Georgia. Will, in response to your answer about Inside Out, Ron Jones, the artist from Tripwire, says, right, I knew it was something like that. Ryan Klein from Laserbred Games and the America's Army Studio asks, what are your thoughts on media molecules work on dreams compared to what you were trying to do in Proxi?
I'm sorry, media molecule? I'm not even familiar with what that is, if it's an app. I should probably check it out.
Yeah, Ryan, if you want to post a little bit more about that in chat, that would be appreciated. Will, you went into some good detail about how people would interact with each other within Proxi. Can you talk a little bit more also about the tools themselves that you and Lauren have been showing the link for here?
Well, we have tools at different levels. We have the memory creation tools and then the world creation tools. And some of these assets might be the same in different categories. I might create a snowman that I allow other players to use in their memories, little, you know, snow globes. I might create a world landscape snowman that I place on a mountain somewhere in my world. Users, I think, are going to have control over, you know, where in the marketplace these appear, how much they cover other players, or they might be free, and they receive earnings as other players use these things. And, you know, it's, again, it could be graphic assets, it could be audio assets, but as I'm crafting a memory and I'm creating unique assets for that, I have the opportunity to now allow other players to have access to these, so that the next time I put a keyword into a memory, I'm getting this whole universe of assets that other players might have created for their own memories. And as I use that, this is almost like in The Sims when people started doing Sims websites and they started posting, you know, unique Sim skins or unique Sim objects, and other players would go and download them. You know, we want to kind of burn that into the game kind of organically and make that part of the game economy as well. So that I think that, you know, more and more, you know, as a game designer, I've thought less and less about how do I make a great game and more about how do I make a great community. You know, so the game really becomes kind of the nucleus for the community of people creating assets and stuff. And then as a proxy to proxy level, that's how I might, you know, meet a lot of other players. It might actually matchmake me with players that have similar psychographs, you know, because I think the understanding that we're going to get about, you know, individual players here is going to be so unique and detailed that it'll be interesting for proxy to go out and find other players that think, you know, the way I think, to a deeper level than I've ever seen before, you know. And I think the advances that we're getting just in, you know, pattern matching, AI, stuff like that, have kind of surprised everybody over the last 5 years, how quickly that's advanced. And we're trying to really take advantage of that.
Excellent. And in regard to Media Molecule, one of the students from the Monday group, Hugo from SCAD, says Media Molecule is the developer dreams is the game on PS4 that lets you build almost anything within it, game, short film, music, all with intuitive in-software tools. And I've heard about it. I haven't played it. But it doesn't really allow much interaction between the different user groups. You all correct me if I'm wrong. There's several excellent related questions. Brood Overmind asks, can you make fictional worlds separate from real memories?
Well, that's actually a really good question, because I think that one of my kind of anchors here is that I wanted to have the world of your memories to be authentic, you know. And I think a lot of players are going to want to make, you know, fictional worlds, fictional memories. And I think that if we go down that path, I think we very well might, what we would do is we would actually give the player different worlds. You know, so I'd have my real world, my real life, my real memories. But I might have another world that's for my dreams or for my aspirations or fantasies. So I would rather segregate that, but still allow the player that freedom to explore and be creative and do cool things. It might also instantiate itself as me creating a fictional character that I make up. Or maybe, you know, some fictional literature, you know, maybe I want to do Horatio Hornblower or whatever, and I start building a whole world, or Robin Hood or whoever. I think players are going to want to do that, and we need to give them the opportunity to do that. But I want to, as much as possible, motivate them to segregate that away from their authentic world so that they just get additional worlds to build.
And we're all quite aware that we have a lot of friends who are going to create memories for themselves, for their alternate egos, for their furry personalities, for their in-game personalities. Yeah. But looking forward.
You could also, just as well, you could do that in one world and have those on different islands in your world. So I might have my world of my fictional aspirations or who I am at Comic-Con or whatever it is, you know. And if you're segregating them within your own world, Proxy will understand that and say, okay, that's a subset of who you are, you know. But those, you know, really are kind of segregated from these memories over here on that continent.
Nobody has memories left after Comic-Con. Brian Reed asks, would there be shared memories, example being a wedding day, but each side having their unique experience for the same event?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I mean, that's exactly one of the things I really want to drill in on with the shared worlds. Is I want to have, you know, one memory. We both went to the same concert or wedding or whatever it is. And within that memory, it has your version of it and my version of it, all in the same memory. But it keeps track of, okay, here's how you saw that, here's how I saw that. And I think that is where we are going to hit a lot of pay dirt, really, you know, in the gameplay. Is, you know, me and my close friends sharing memories, and then Proxy coming back and pointing out the differences we have in these interpretations of the world.
Excellent. We are at 3:45. Will and Lauren definitely appreciate all your input here. We'll take one last question, mainly because it's from Justin Collins, who's been one of our Reg volunteers for a long time. For those of you who don't know, that is the Button Hat himself. You've briefly touched on being able to connect with like-minded proxies of other users. Would there be ways to search out different proxies by type, subject, etc.?
Well, honestly, we haven't quite gotten to that. Yes, I mean, we definitely have to have some kind of matchmaking abilities in here as we get to the proxy to proxy level. And, you know, we're just to the point now of kind of distinguishing, you know, fictional proxies from historic proxies, from real proxies, which might be your friends, family, or it could be, you know, strangers you've never met. But Proxy says, hey, you know, the two of you have a lot in common. Here it is. Do you want to connect? So we're just to the point, you know, in the design right now of digging into that right now. But, yes, I think that is something that we definitely want as a feature.
All right. Artisan JPEG says, like, hashtags, maybe, which is an interesting comparison between the two.
Yeah.
And, Will, we thank you very much for this presentation. I will move Will into the GGDA voice channel. You are all welcome to join him in voice. We'll have mods keeping an eye on things, but we know you're all a great group.